BBC Audio presents Struck Off and Die, a classic BBC Radio 4 sketch show. This release collects all three series of Phil Hammond and Tony Gardner's award-winning show, bringing it together with a behind-the-scenes look at the comedy duo when they played at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival in the 90s. Opening this BBC collection, we have excerpts from the first episode of Edinburgh 90, which was originally broadcast on Radio 4 on the 13th of July, 1991. It features backstage interviews with the comedy duo and clips of Struck Off and Die entertaining the Edinburgh Fringe Festival audience with their anarchic insights. The producer of Edinburgh 90, which aired in two parts, was Sarah Smith.
Hello and welcome to Edinburgh.
In August 1990, visitors to the Edinburgh Fringe Festival had over 7,000 performances to choose from. Among them were the shows of three companies whose fortunes we followed. Newcomers to the Fringe, Friends of the Famous, Professional Company and Fringe Veterans, Lip Service, and Struck Off and Die, two junior doctors with a comedy mission. Every midnight at the Celtic Lodge on the Royal Mile, Dr. Phil Hammond and Dr. Tony Gardner presented an amateur medical review with a difference.
Where the hell have you been? I've been looking for you for the last 5 minutes.
What do you mean?
I'm not doing the chocolates down that side. We've had a problem backstage and I've been looking for you. I need you in this sort of emergency situation.
What's happened?
You know those sort of Amazon girls, the Cambridge footlights?
Yeah, they're very good. Go and see the Amazon.
Phil, please, can you come back? One of them's actually had a bit of an accident backstage.
What do you mean an accident?
She's had an arrest. She's like flat out there, flat out, and I want you to come out and give me a hand. I don't know what to do.
Tony, how do they teach you in hospital to deal with cardiac arrest? How do they teach you? It's see one, do one, teach one, all right? It's the only way to learn. It's see one, do one, teach one. I won't tell you again. Sorry. Coconut cream, folks. Any day for a coconut cream. Two more coffees, two coffees in a row. All the coffees. Lime barrel. You come.
Tony, for God's sake, look, I've got in the whole box. I've got three to go. What are you doing?
I'm really annoyed with you.
What's happened?
Baby Jesus will punish you.
Tony, baby Jesus will not punish me. Sit down and tell me, what's the trace doing? How can I help you if you won't tell me what the trace is doing? No, that's all right, Tony. That means that she's peaceful now.
It's okay, lads, you can stop. She's peaceful now.
Just take it all on board.
Tony, you're a typical GP, aren't you? Why are you getting so worked up about this? Somebody in Britain has a stroke every 5 minutes.
No.
Oh, God. One in four of our over 75s have Alzheimer's disease.
Oh, no, don't.
An animal dies in an experiment every it's 6 seconds.
So empathic.
And in the Lothian district alone last year, 15,000 bicycles were stolen.
We both had a bit of experience in medical school, doing medical school shows, which we talk about in the show. And so we decided that we might as well give it a shot and take it up to the Fringe in Edinburgh.
We noted that Medical Reviews had won the Worst Show on the Fringe Award for the last 2 years, and we felt we could put medical humour back on the map. But we also saw it as an ideal opportunity to politicise the plight of our junior doctors and to wage a war of ridicule on the caring professions, if you like. There's an awful lot going on in the health service that goes on behind closed doors, and we felt we'd open those doors a bit. Isn't that right, Tony?
That's right, Phil.
Yes, we're also looking for fame and wealth as well. I don't think there's anything too wrong with that.
And fortune in the middle of those.
And
two.
Fortune as well. Yeah. The old spit and sawdust and the lamps keep going and we're losing lots of money. But that's what the Fringe is all about. No, I think we will make money. We'll at least break even. And we're looking on this as a holiday. We've taken 2 weeks' holiday.
It started off being a bit of a holiday. Then after about seven nights, it's getting a bit tiring because bearing in mind that we go on at midnight, don't finish till 1:30. And then by the time we've cleared up and signed autographs and things, we didn't get to the Fringe Club until 2. I mean, we haven't had much time because we're both working full time at the moment. We've got this show together. And what we've hoped all along is that, right, we'll get a funny show that people will laugh, and hopefully they do. But also, at some point, they stop laughing and they realise that, although this sounds like a funny story, should we be laughing at it? We're saying there's a reason for having medical humour. It's black humour, very black humour, that is used in our profession as a way of coming to terms with very horrible and real situations that we have every day.
But we're getting such a favourable response, and we're selling out really by word of mouth. We haven't been reviewed. We've only just been reviewed in the evening news, which
was eight
was great. But yet, as totally unknown group coming up, only having performed 13 times and rehearsed once, we've now sold out every night by word of mouth, and people turning out paying £3.50 at midnight to come and see us. Mm. And I find that very, very rewarding.
And examining patients can sometimes be really amusing. I remember this confused old lady when I was doing my house jobs who'd been bleeding from her tail end, and I had to examine the rectum. And I tried to explain this to her, and I wasn't really sure whether she understood, so I put my glove on, and I stuck my finger up her tail end, and she lifted her head off the pillow, and she went, "Is that you, George?" I don't know if George is here tonight. Actually, confused old ladies are my favourite patients because they're just on another planet. One of the geriatricians in Bath had to do a home visit on a lady who was anemic, very old lady, and once again he introduced himself and he took her upstairs and did a full examination. You know, the breasts and the back and the front end and the back end, and he took about half an hour over it. And he carried this woman down the stairs afterwards and she turned to him and she said, "Are you the doctor?" No, I'm the man from Del Monte. Just checking my pineapple rings, yeah.
I don't really think there's anything particularly different about us, our stuff. We're talking openly as doctors, but the basis of a lot of humour is other people's misfortune, whether you have the misfortune to slip on a banana skin or whether you have the misfortune to have cancer. You know, people often find it amusing because it's not them. And the power of our stuff is that people also laugh at what they're frightened about. Some people are finding it profoundly shocking, some people are finding it very, very funny. And although the anecdotes have been slightly altered to protect confidentiality, they are all true. This is what we have to deal with. And the point really is that we're not trained to. You just don't get heard. And every year it happens. There'll be a story about doctor's hours and everyone goes, "Isn't it appalling? I hope it doesn't happen to me." But we need to mobilise the public. That's the thinking behind it. We must get the public behind the junior doctors.
The beauty of medicine, though, folks, is that there's so much to whinge about, isn't there? If junior doctors were prisoners of war, then under the Geneva Convention, the sleep deprivation they suffer from would be considered torture. I think the BBC should do a series on it. They could call it Kenko. Because when you haven't slept all weekend, you'd kill for a cup of real coffee, wouldn't you? And often at the end of a weekend shift, you hear that marvellous sound coming at you from the far end of the corridor, don't you? It's sort of... So you go sprinting down the wall going, "Where's the coffee? Where's the coffee? Where's the coffee?" Only to find it's some old bugger in the side room with a death rattle. What? No coffee in here? Shit! It's all very sad, really, but even the really minor things you tend to get confused at when you haven't slept. I remember having to phone a consultant up at 3 o'clock in the morning when I was doing obstetrics and saying, "Look, I'm really sorry, sir, I've forgotten. Is it the baby or the placenta that comes first?" And there was a pause. He said, "Well, it's so long since I did one, I can't really remember." And then finally he said, "Look, Dr. Hammond, I think the thing is in obstetrics, you give the mother whichever one's better looking." "Oh, congratulations, you've got twins."
This is actually something that we do every day in our jobs. That's something we're trained at, to make few people feel comfortable, and perhaps that's a skill that we've got. We both really like being doctors, believe it or not. And we don't actually mention that all the way through. When you said, you know, we're sort of undermining the very thing that we're trying to defend, and that could be right in a way.
But a lot of this, for me anyway, is like a catharsis or an exorcism of some of the ideas I've always wanted to get out of my system, and now I am, and I feel much better having done it. Oh, that sounds very deep. Sorry, Sue's corner. Say something quickly, Tony.
I agree. I'm not going to start going on and getting the second paragraph of Sue's corner after Phil's bit, but...
Like all political satires, you can sometimes ram it down people's throats, and so we're trying to get a subtle balance.
There's nothing worse than feeling too uncomfortable when you go and see a show, so we have kept it down just to that one moment, I think, really, where they do suddenly question why are they laughing at something, which is the part where Phil talks about the baby who has hydrocephalus, which is profoundly shocking.
Basically, folks, there are two types of doctor. There are those doctors that mention cancer and those that don't. When I was a student, I sat in on a busy gynaecology clinic being taken by a locum who was working part-time, who'd been up all night, didn't have time to read the notes, and didn't know any of the patients. And this woman came in, she sat down, and he said, "Well, Mrs. Jenkins, you'll be pleased to know that you haven't got cervical cancer." "Oh, yes, you have!" It's interesting what people laugh at, isn't it? People write to us and they say, "Oh, you can mention strokes and heart attacks, but you shouldn't mention cancer," or "Strokes, heart attacks and cancer are okay, but you shouldn't mention babies dying." I can't really see how you make those distinctions. Of course, the press tends to focus in on death and dying in babies because it's a very emotive subject. One of the jobs we used to have to do when I did obstetrics and also pediatrics, when a mother had a stillbirth or the baby was born abnormal and died shortly afterwards, quite often they didn't want to see the baby, fair enough. And so we used to have to take it away, round to the sluice room and examine it, and then to help with the grief reaction later, we have to take a photograph of it. Now, if the baby was normally formed, that was fine. If the baby was abnormal, we had a real trouble trying to get a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.